that there's a brighter future. But to get to that brighter future takes work on my part today. There's a montage of Billy Graham preaching where he cries out, "Where is the hope?" We need to revisit that question, especially on a day like today. Where is the hope? Because if the hope is in a strong military, eventually it will fail. If the hope is in our law enforcement, eventually they will fall down. If the hope is in our fire protection, eventually we will be burned up. If our hope is in our churches, eventually you will be let down. If our hope is in the home, there will be bad parents and abuse. We've got to get back to the only hope that makes a difference. We've been given that hope, and His name is Jesus. Because Jesus will fix the home, and Jesus will fix the nations, and Jesus will fix the world. But only Jesus brings the hope that we need. For in the end, the Lord has said there will be a new heaven and a new earth. The victory is ours. This earth, the old shall pass away and the new will come. The hope is complete in Jesus Christ, though it's yet not come. But it is coming. And today is one of those days. And every day that we wake up and say today is the day that we need to share the hope with a hopeless world. Because the societal ills, the struggles of today are answered in the person of Jesus Christ. In His death, sacrificially, as the perfect Lamb of God, the sacrifice that set all things straight. In the burial, when Jesus was absent from this world for 3 days. Spiritually absent. His body lay in a tomb. He had not yet ascended to the heavens, for He tells us in resurrection, "Don't touch me, I'm not yet ascended to my Father." He had not been punished for the sin of man, because Jesus was perfect and no punishment could hold Him. But Jesus, we are told in Scriptures, did descend. I believe He descended to Hades, because that's what we're told here in Scripture we're going to look at this morning in Acts chapter 2. But He didn't go there to receive punishment, but to declare the victory to Satan. Because not only would He declare the victory, but He would rise from the grave on the third day. And He would walk on earth for 40 days. And He will ascend, or did ascend, to the right hand of the Father, where He reigns today. So when we ask the question, where is the hope? The hope is in our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. The hope is not in government. The hope is not in military power. The hope is not in physical strength. The hope is not in medical advancement. The hope for life today and for eternity is in Jesus Christ. Again, join me in Acts chapter 2. We ended last week in verse 28. And today, as we go through the next 10 or so verses, 11 verses, we are going to see the hope that is restored to mankind, that is given to mankind for all times for those who will believe on the name of Jesus. The hope is not lost. The best is not behind. The best is yet to come if our hope's in Jesus. Brothers, Peter speaking again, just as he continued his sermon from last week, as he began to fill the minds of the people with the truth, as the Holy Spirit has empowered him. Brothers, I can confidently speak to you about the patriarch David. He is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him to seat one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing this in advance, he spoke concerning the resurrection of the Messiah. He did not, resurrection of the Messiah. He was not left in Hades, and his flesh did not experience decay. God has resurrected this Jesus. We are all witnesses of this. Therefore, since he has been exalted to the right hand of God and has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, he has poured out what you both see and hear. For it was not David who ascended into the heavens, but he himself says, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified. He's made him both Lord and Master, Messiah. Then they heard this, and they were pierced to their heart. And Peter said to the rest of the apostles, brothers, what must we do? And Peter replied, repent and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus the Messiah, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift, the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified, and he strongly urged them, saying, be saved from this corrupt generation. What a powerful sermon. What a simple sermon. What a appropriate sermon for our world, our church, our community today. Peter's words are just as true today as they were when he spoke them under the influence and the power of the Holy Spirit. If we start the chapter, when power came upon them, when the Holy Spirit dwelt upon them, they began to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ to the point of people thinking they were drunk. They were all hearing them in their own native languages. And Peter begins an eloquent sermon saying, we're not drunk, it's too early in the morning. But we do have something different about us today. There is something that has changed us today. It's not a something, it's a someone. The Holy Spirit has come upon them. And this morning, as we pick up at verse 29, he begins to speak about David. David was the hope of Israel. When Saul had fallen, and David picked up the reins of the empire, the Israeli nation, he led them to great victory, defeating all the neighboring tribes, unified in Jerusalem. David began the kingdom of Israel, the nation of Israel, in all of its power, and all of its might, and all of its glory. The heyday, the day they look back to and say, I wish it was like that again. But David knew he wasn't the one. David knew his work was only temporary. And as he ended his life, he called upon Solomon to build the temple, the next step to continue the good work that had begun. And for 40 years, Solomon reigned until his death. And then the hope seemed to be lost. Because bad ruler after bad ruler, destruction after destruction, dispersion after dispersion, the Israelites scattered and the remnant brought back, and the Israelites scattered and the remnant brought back, and the Roman Empire is now taken over in a ruling God's once proud and glorious land. And Peter gets up to speak among the people. Brothers, David knew that he was not the one. If David was the one, we wouldn't be in the shape we're in today. But he said concerning the Christ, he was not left in Hades. I get some pushback sometimes on my belief that Jesus descended. Of course, Scripture tells us very clearly, in order to ascend, he first had to descend. And to get away from this, you've got to disagree with Scripture. That puts you at odds with God. What he did, we may debate. I believe he went and set the captives free, not to set those in hell free, because they had earned their punishment. But he went to tell Satan, I have victory over you. You no longer reign. I reign. It's no longer your power, it's my power. You no longer have the control that you thought you once had. But I have proven that not only can I, but I have and I will reign over you. And on the third day, he rose again. And his flesh will not experience decay. in the Israeli tradition, on the fourth day, they believed the decay began on the physical body. Jesus was resurrected on the third day. Decay did not hit his body. Peter's preaching the truth of the scriptures, the truth of what Jesus has shown him, the truth of what actually happened. He's bringing this information to light in the minds of those who gathered around. At this time, the Israelite people are listening to Peter preach. Something amazing has happened in that upper room, and we're told that they left where they were, and they came and they gathered to hear this sermon. And Peter is preaching. And in verse 32, he says, God has resurrected this Jesus. It comes back to the resurrection. It always comes back to the resurrection. There's power in the blood because of the resurrection. The resurrection is what makes this so important and valuable. It's where we hang our hats. It's where we get our confidence. And He wants us to be confident. He wants us to know the truth. Not to wonder, not to guess, not to be distracted by other things. God has resurrected this Jesus. It's God's business of salvation. It's God's hope for the world. It's God who does the work in our lives as He does it here in Jesus Christ. He says, we are all the witnesses of this. Not one, but many witnesses. There were over 500 who saw Jesus in the flesh resurrected. I was listening to an apologist on the radio just the other day, and he was talking about this moment of resurrection, or this piece of history. You know the one piece of scripture that's not debated by historians is the reality of Jesus Christ. They agree that Jesus was a man who lived in Jerusalem or in Israel during this time period. They all agree that He was real. Most of them agree that historical accounts include this Jesus who was crucified being seen in the flesh. There's no debate, for the most part, over the resurrection. The debate is, was He swooning in the tomb, not really dead, and just kind of woke up out of a coma? Or did He really die and resurrect? The scripture is very clear that He died, that His spirit descended, and then it ascended, and He had victory over death. God has resurrected this Jesus. We are witnesses. There is no debate about this. Verse 33, therefore, since He has been exalted to the right hand of God and has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, He has poured out what you both see and hear. What Jesus received from the Father, the gift of the Holy Spirit, He then poured out on the apostles. And then He's getting ready to tell us in just a few more verses that if you receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you get this gift too. We need hope. Where is the hope? The hope is in Jesus. He has defeated death. He has resurrected. He has received the Holy Spirit. He has poured out His Spirit upon the people who receive Him as Lord. He has poured out the promised Holy Spirit. For it was not David who ascended into the heavens. Man could not do this. Our hope is not in man. Man will let us down. Man is not able to do the things that only God can do. Every man who's ever lived, except maybe two who are taken up in a whirlwind, has died. I even think they died, quite frankly. I do. Most people don't, but I think they did. If they did or didn't, doesn't matter. What matters to Jesus is God's one and only Son, who died according to Scripture, who rose according to Scripture, and who reigns according to Scripture. For it was not David who ascended into the heavens. Man could not do it. But David said, the Lord said to my Lord, God said to Christ, same name used for both of them, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, because God is able to do all things, therefore, because God is able to set forth the perfect sacrifice in raising from the dead, therefore, since God did the work of salvation, let all the house of Israel know with certainty, no doubt, God doesn't want us wandering around wondering. God doesn't want us questioning whether or not we can be saved. God doesn't want us without assurance that we've been saved. Therefore, He wants us to know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, catch this part, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. I want you to know with certainty you killed God's only begotten Son. That's kind of in the face, isn't it? Well, Peter's pointing four fingers back at himself because Peter's the one sitting at the fire denying Jesus. It's the sin of man that crucified Christ. You're listening to me giving you the hope, but understand the hope came because of your sin. You're a part of the consequence of sin. You caused the death of Jesus. It's your fault. But God didn't hold that against you. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty, we don't want to miss that word certainty, that God's made this Jesus, the only Jesus, the one and only. By the way, is there more than one Jesus? There's only one Lord and Savior. We got a fellow at the State Convention Office named Jesus. He's our Hispanic consultant. They got all kinds of religions out there who claim to have a Savior named Jesus. But He's not my Jesus. Is there more than one Jesus? There's more than one person or entity or demon or idol or God, the lowercase g, named Jesus. Don't get confused. The Jesus that brings resurrection is that Jesus. Peter's being very specific here. It's this Jesus. It's the one who God sent to a mother named Mary in a land called Nazareth of Galilee. It's this Jesus who we've been walking with for the last 3 years, giving up everything, home, family, and work, to learn under, to serve beside, to follow. It's this Jesus who you crucified. There's only one of these Jesuses. It's this Jesus who's God's only begotten Son. And there's only one way to heaven, and it's through this Jesus, not any Jesus, but let's make sure we have the right Jesus, the Jesus of Scripture. Because all others will lead to hell. All other gods, little g, will lead to hell. But there is the Jesus who is the Son of God who brings hope. There is the Jesus, the Son of God, this Jesus who will bring peace to a broken world. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, very specific here, both Lord and Messiah. God has taken His only begotten Son, the sacrificial death on the cross. He has now raised Him from the dead and set Him on the throne to be worshipped. He is both Lord Adonai and Messiah. He is both my name and the redemptive Messiah. The work is completed. There is not another. Messiah is not coming because Messiah has come. And I want you to know with certainty that it was the Jesus that you crucified on the cross who is resurrected again, who we have witnessed in the flesh. This Jesus is the hope of the world. There is hope. It's not over. It is not done. But it is this Jesus, not to be mistaken by those who go by His name, those who have false religion and false teachings, but this Jesus that God sent, He is the one who brings the hope of the world. He is both Lord, Adonai, and Messiah, Christ. And when they heard this, when they heard the truth of who Jesus was, look what it says it was. When they heard this, they were pierced to the heart. You know what that means? Pierced to the heart? Jesus does. Jesus was pierced to the heart. He had a spear stuck in His side up underneath the ribs that went right into the heart. It separated the what's it called? Pericardium. Was that the right sac around the heart? And the water drained out separate from the blood. Jesus knows what it's like to have a heart pierced. They now know what it's like to have a heart pierced. It's that crushing blow that comes when you realize that you're the one who's wrong. Now, unfortunately, I have this feeling quite often where I think I'm right. In fact, I know I'm right. And then my wife informs me I'm wrong. Then I realize I'm wrong because she's right. Whether she's wrong or not, she's right. She's usually right. She's not in here. I can say it when she's not around. Don't say it when she is. And then you have to, as we would say in today's world, eat crow. You have to recognize you're wrong and make it right. You get, it's a sharp pain because it's not easy to be wrong. Why has any of your husbands ever been wrong? Just a few. Husbands, any of your wives ever been wrong? Don't raise your hand. We've all been wrong. You ever been really wrong? And we're convinced you were right? I mean, argumentative, right? And then you realized you were wrong? It feels horrible, doesn't it? None of us like to be that wrong. The Israelites who are hearing Peter speak just realized not only were they wrong, but their wrongness sent Jesus to the cross. It cost the life of their Lord and Savior. Anyone ever been so wrong that somebody else died because of your decision? Memorial Day. There are soldiers who come back from war destroyed emotionally. Because in the heat of battle, they had to make a decision that meant life and death. Now, whether it was the right or the wrong decision in this scenario, this illustration doesn't matter so much. As they made the decision that had to be made in that split second that caused other people's lives to be lost. And they come home crushed, destroyed, and unable to rejoin society as a complete person. It's happened, and it's happening. They don't understand why, but it's the reality. Our decisions matter. Every decision matters. Now, some have been able to make that decision to come home, struggle with the consequences, and find hope, and to continue to live, and to continue to be productive members of society. I think the difference is some have learned to find hope, even in the midst of the struggle, even in the midst of the disappointment. They have found a way to find forgiveness. They have found a way to be filled with something good, even in the midst of the deep despair of something really bad. Then here, as Peter speaks to these people, he calls them to the realization that their decision for sin caused the death of the one who loved them more than his own life. Of the one who was willing to lay down his life for his friends. Of the one who was willing to lay down his life for his enemies. He calls them to that point of understanding that you were wrong. You crucified the one that is Lord and Messiah. In verse 37, here's the hope. We need the hope. He asked the question, where is the hope? Here is the hope. When they heard this, they were pierced to the heart. And they said to Peter and the apostles, brothers, what must we do? And the answer comes, repent and be baptized. Each of you, it's not a corporate thing, it's an individual thing. Repent simply means this. Recognize your wrongfulness. Own it. Admit it. I'm a sinner. That's confession. But it's more than just confession. Confession is agreement with God. God already knows you're a sinner. All you got to do is agree with Him you're a sinner. And God, I'm willing to change my way of life. When it says repent, tell God, I'm sorry I crucified your son. And because of my wrongfulness, I love you because you love me. And I'm willing to serve you. I give up my will to your will. I make you Lord of my life. I make you my master. I am willing to be your servant. Because of my wrongfulness, I deserve death. Because of your grace, I'm given life. Therefore, I will serve you because I love you, because you loved me when I wasn't worthy. Repent and be baptized. Baptism is this, showing the world that you're changed. is confessing Jesus as Savior. It is agreeing with a group of people that I'm with you, not against you. It is a picture of the death and new birth that comes in salvation, buried with Christ in baptism, and raised to walk in a new way of life. Romans 6:4. Repent and be baptized, each of you. This is an individual decision. You don't get this as a group. This is not a nation of Israel kind of thing. This is a one-on-one between you and God. Each of you needs to repent and say you were wrong. Each of you needs to receive the hope that comes from God and be baptized so the world knows that you're different. Each of you do this in the name, in the character, in the nature, in the being of Jesus the Messiah. We need to make sure that when we're committing our hearts and lives to the Lord, that we understand that we're committing ourselves to Jesus who brings us the hope. We do this, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. You see, you can't make it to heaven with your sins attached. It's too much weight. It's too much baggage. It's too much to carry on your own. You can't make it to heaven until you're washed clean. Y'all have a Saturday night ritual that we have in our house. It's bath time. You don't get to come into the house of the Lord until you get the dirtiness of the week off your body. Saturday's a busy day. It's a hot day. It's an outside day. It's a fun day. But when you're doing all that, you get stinky. You get sweaty. You get dirty. You need to have a bath before you come into the house of the Lord. He says you need to be baptized, not to get you physically clean, so that you recognize that you're spiritually clean for the forgiveness of sins. It's God cleansing you of all unrighteousness. When you receive God through repentance and follow God through baptism, obedience, your sins are forgiven. It says, and each of you in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins are forgiven. You have to have your sins forgiven. You can't make it into his heaven. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Once you're cleansed and made clean and made pure, now you're a new vessel. Remember Jesus teaching about the wineskins? Baptists don't teach that one, do they? Why do you need a new wineskin? Because the old wineskin was hard. It was dried out. It was inflexible. It was brittle. Now, that does describe some of the Christians I know. But that shouldn't be our goal, should it? Because Christ says that when you're born again, you become a new skin, don't you? Because in the new skin, it's fresh, it's soft, it's supple, it's able to expand, to hold the good stuff that's getting ready to get poured inside. The old is gone and the new has come, according to Jesus. So when you receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, the hope is about to come and the Holy Spirit's going to be poured into you. But God won't pour something new that needs to be expanded into an old wineskin. That's why the old is gone, is dead, is buried. It is decayed. But the new has come. There's a new birth, a second birth, a perfect birth, a regeneration that can't happen in any other way. When it happens, it's complete. And you can never go back to what you once were. Because once you become that new skin, you are filled with the Holy Spirit. And the scripture becomes true that says he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. The scripture becomes true that says that those who are given to the Father cannot be snatched from his hands. The scripture becomes true that says that we are his, a new creation, to never again be what we once were. Because we have a new identity. We have a new possession. And we have a new destination. It says that we become ambassadors of Jesus Christ. That we are foreigners or aliens in this land. That our citizenship is in heaven, not on earth. And so we need to confess, repent, be baptized for the forgiveness of our sins, receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Each, it says, has to receive. But the gift is for you and for your children and for those who are far off. in two ways. I praise the Lord for far off, by the way, because I'm not in Jerusalem. I'm in a land that's far away. I'm far off geographically. I praise the Lord for far off geographically. I also praise the Lord for far off spiritually. Because weren't you once blind? Weren't you once following the ways of your sinful desires? Weren't you once far away from Jesus? But the Lord died, rose again, reigns at the right hand, so that as many as the Lord calls, those who are here today, those who are shared with by those who are here today, for those who are nearby and those who are far off, for the family to become family. Jesus died, and He rose again. Where is the hope? The hope is not in our own good decision making. The hope is not in our churches. I'll let that sink in. I know I've said it a few times. I just want you to realize that's not where the hope is. The hope is in Jesus. If the church is filled with people who are filled with Jesus, then the church becomes a beacon of hope. But the church itself is not the hope. And I mean that both in the building and the individual Christian. I am not the hope. I simply shine light on the hope. I'm a reflection of the hope. I'm an ambassador of the hope. The hope is not in me. I can't teach you to be good enough. I can't teach you to know enough. I can't teach you to praise enough. Because the hope is not in me. The hope is in Jesus. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, because He is the hope. If you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, are you carrying this hope to your children and to those who are far away? Because that's our calling. If you're walking with the Lord, are you walking with the light on so that others can see the hope in you? Because I do believe the hope is in you if you're in Jesus Christ. Are you going to be part of taking the hope to this lost, dying world? It starts with knowing Jesus. Jesus was God's only Son. He was sent to earth to live a perfect life, a sinless life. He achieved this. Somewhere around the age of 33, He was placed on a sinner's cross, wrongly convicted, for He was perfect, and killed. Roman crucifixion, spear in His side. He was laid in a tomb that was borrowed because He didn't need it for long, only 3 days. On the third day, He rose again, defeating death and Hades, declaring victory, walking on earth for 40 days, ascending to the right hand of the Father. If you don't know Jesus, He did this for you so that you could have hope and victory. You know Jesus. If you repented of your sins, proclaimed Him as Savior, and confessed Him before man. If you're willing to do this, today, the Scripture says, you'll be saved. In that moment, you will be saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, who is your gift from God, assuring you eternity in heaven and peace on earth today. Not a change of life, not a change of location, but the comfort that only comes from the Holy Spirit. If you're in Christ, are you walking with Him? Are you shining the light? Are you proclaiming as Peter proclaimed, truth of sin and truth of salvation that only comes in Jesus? Let me pray for you. Paul's going to come and lead us. You'll have an opportunity to respond. Father, we love You. We thank You for the privilege of being in Your house. We thank You for the truth of Your Word. We thank You for all that You've done. And now, Lord, as we respond to You through song, but also for those who need to receive Christ, if they've already prayed in their hearts, that they would come forward this morning to confess You before this congregation so that we can share together the good work that You're doing. Father, for those who know you, who need to repent to be set straight, who need to be renewed and refreshed, Lord, we just ask that they'd have the courage to step out to do that, to glorify you, to honor you, and just to say, today I have recommitted, I have continued my walk, I have restored my relationship with Jesus Christ through his forgiveness. Father, speak to us today and help us to respond to you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Will you stand with me? We're going to sing. I'll be here to receive you. You respond.
Aside from VBS, we've got a lot of slots open. It's down.
inside as you leave. Check the list if you're able to teach, if you're able to be the lead person in the room, if you're able to help with crafts, if you're able to crowd control. Sign up. Also, on the right-hand side as you go, where I am, we have a prayer, a month of prayer leading up to VBS available, so you can pray through each day of the month. So there's a prayer calendar down there as well.
Well, Larry's our Deacon of the Week. He's going to come close our service.
Hey, up here, if you can't see the trees from the forest. By the way, I'm sporting a gift here, and Bud knew I was about to say something about it. This represents hope for those drivers today who want to do that. But you know, I think I'd like to wear my red, white, and blue next week, because that's traditional, the real day, and that's what I remember. There is a hope that's in Jesus. We put our faith and trust in Him. You know, that's where our victory lies. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord, for the message of hope. Hope in Jesus. Thank you for all that Jesus went through. The sacrifice. And that's what gains victory is sacrifice. So help us now, Lord, as we go to our Sunday school classes and we bring in the word into our life that we might stand firm and be able to resist the wiles of the devil throughout the week. In His name, in the name